I want to thank you, all of you, for coming here in this weather. I know people came from all the way from south side and the northwest. I really appreciate, and let me introduce you the board we have here, American Muslim Task Force. We have board members sitting at that table. They will take notes while you will speak, and then I'll discuss further about the procedure, how it's going to go. So I will invite Faisal Hamuda, Sheikh Faisal Hamuda, to come and recite a few verses of Holy Quran and then translation. Thank you.
The borders of Egypt now. You are safe with us. And then his daughter looked at him and said, Dad, why don't you hire him? The best man that you can hire is the competent and the honest. I'm sure everybody is going to be bombarded with this story on TV, the Ten Commandments and but I just like everybody to know the Quranic version of the same story. Moses didn't take advantage of the two ladies, and he has been going in the desert for months and months. And he didn't ask him for pay back. And he didn't take advantage of their father, because it turned out that their father was a wealthy man. But he did it for the sake of humanity. He did it for the sake of truth. And this is the time that we hope and pray that the winning candidate are going to be the competent and the honest. They are not persuaded by any special interest groups. They are not there except to serve their country and to serve their conscience and to find the truth and uphold the truth. Thank you very much, and God bless all of you.
Again, thank you for coming. Let me introduce you about the American Muslim Task Force. The American Muslim Task Force on Civil Rights and Elections is an umbrella organization represented by 10 national Muslim organizations such as American Muslim Alliance, Council on American-Islamic Relations, Islamic Circle of North America, Islamic Society of North America, Muslim Alliance of North America, Muslim Public Affairs Council, and Muslim Student Association. We have 22 chapters nationwide. We register people to vote, set up town hall meetings, civic education programs to educate our community about the political system, candidates forum, and candidate endorsements. According to the ZAPI poll, commissioned by the Georgetown University and released on October 19, 2004, 81% of American Muslims nationally supported AMT's plan, election plan, including its civil rights plus agenda, which emphasized civil and human rights for all, domestic issues of public good and general welfare, global peace with justice, prevention of war, and U.S. relations with the Muslim world. Recent ZOPI polls released on May 18, 2007 shows that Muslims are a politically active group. A high proportion of registered Muslim voters, which is 95%, plan to vote in national elections. And of that group, 88% are very likely to vote. According to University of Maryland researcher James Gimple, due to AMT's efforts, 21% of the Muslims voted in 2004 were the first-time voters. According to Licit Pool of Washington Report on Middle East, AMT's effort for agenda setting, coalition building, skill formation, and negotiated accommodation of American Muslim interests have made progress in each area, though not the same level of success. The efficacy of our town hall meetings and forums prompted the New York State-based Observer Dispatch on April 17 this year to comment in their editorial page. Quote, "No shows at the ballot box might take a lesson from American Muslims, who are stepping up in efforts to assume an active role in the nation's political process," unquote. So this election, we will use the electoral process to recognize ourselves along democratic issues by building up bottom-up multi-institutional decision-making mechanism. We will maintain opposition in oppression by building a nationwide civil rights coalition. Only such a coalition can restore America to its ideals and principles. Now we know that all candidates sitting here are not gonna make the policy making on the nation, you know, national issues, but we have Congresswoman Jane Schakowsky here, who definitely will, and all other candidates, congressional candidates. We wish them all good luck, and we're going to start the program now. I would like to start the event with the voter recognition commissioners and candidates who are running for voter recognition district commission. We have about five candidates sitting here, incumbents and candidates. But I will ask Honorable Alderman Bernie Sohn to come here. Give him a big hand. He will introduce all those candidates. Thank you, Alderman.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to act as a person who had the opportunity to introduce the candidates who are present today, who are running for the Water Reclamation District. We are very fortunate that all of the candidates who are present today, both not only for the Water Reclamation District, but for all of the offices, are extremely well qualified and are deserving of our consideration. To you, my Muslim brothers, I would hope that you will consider well those who present their qualifications, and will consider their qualifications when you make your recommendations to your brothers for their votes.
I'm glad to announce that Alderman Stone converted to Islam, that's why he's not here. I'm just kidding.
Well, you've always been my brothers, as you know.
Right. And because of this, right?
That's correct. I believe, Ms. Mary Zappos, you're first on the ballot, are you not? So we're going to ask you if you would. Salman has asked me to ask the candidates to make a presentation and asked me to have them limit their presentation to 3 to 5 minutes, even though I know that it's very difficult to make any presentation that limits yourself to that length of time, but please present that, and then we'll open it to members of the board for questioning. Thank you.
This is also going to be put on CAN TV. This cameraman is from CAN TV, and we'll put this debate, the whole thing, on Google and YouTube as well.
Thank you, Alderman Stone. As was noted, my name is Mariana Sporopoulos, and I am running for one of the three positions that's open for Water Reclamation District. I am an attorney in Chicago with an MBA from Loyola University, and this is my first time running for public office. So I do take the message that was noted by the Sheikh earlier of honest and competent and someone who will respond to the voters and answers only to the voters very seriously. The reason why I'm running for Water Reclamation District is my concern for the environment. This summer, we recently saw BP and U.S. Steel dumping in Lake Michigan. We saw companies that are willing to compromise our natural resources, and that is not something that we can sit by and take lightly. I wanted to be a voice versus just a vote. I wanted to send a message to these companies, and I also would like the public to get involved in water conservation. I think that the Water Reclamation District can take a greater role in preserving our natural resources, and one way they can do that is setting up an educational program to get the public involved in water conservation. Number two, they can engage environmentally conscious technologies on their own premises. As one of the largest landowners in Cook County, they can engage these technologies into their premises and set the example for the public. And number three, as an agency with a $1.3 billion budget, and as I said, one of the largest landowners in Cook County, they need to be a more transparent agency so that the general public knows how their bidding contracts take place and how our tax dollars are being spent. Therefore, as running for office for the first time, I would like these three agendas to be one of my main priorities, and I would like the environment to take priority on every government agency's agenda, and that would be my first priority. I am endorsed by our state treasurer, Alexi Janulius, by Congresswoman Jan Schakowsky, by Commissioner Larry Sufferton, amongst many other government officials, and I'm very proud, and I hope to make them proud of their endorsement of me, and I look forward to your support on February 5th. Thank you very much.
I will open the questions from the board.
Any questions?
place your opponent, you know, on that day?
How do I place my opponents? Very carefully. There's many very qualified and worthy people that are running for the three positions for Water Reclamation District. And everyone has their own focus. I think there are a few people that are looking at the environment, but I don't think there are enough. I know that that is my primary focus. So I hope that the general public sees that that's something that's important. In light of what I said, the news, we've seen several stories in the Tribune and other news sources where companies are dumping in the lake. And I think some of our other candidates will be talking about that as well. And it's something that we need to look at for our children and for future generations. Because the decisions that we make now are going to affect future generations. We're at a generational crossroads right now where the decisions that we make today are going to affect the resources that we have available in the future. Yes,
sir. You have a budget for $1.3 million. Are you going to pledge to us here today to get elected to give minorities a big chance to go to contracts and opportunity to work in the department?
I pledge that all people would get a chance to get contracts at the Water Reclamation District. I think it's very important that everybody have an opportunity to play in this kind of environment, especially an environment at the Water Reclamation District that has so many contracts. Yes, sir.
As you said, this is a very important safety issue, the pollution and the environment. And it has been shown in the past several years, incidents where it has been dangerous to public health. Now, you said about the company, but the company's going to try to buy it.
Thank you,
and they're going to put you down. And that's what they have been always doing. So what are you going to do for them?
I'm going to say no.
That's easy.
If they try to buy me. Like I said, this is my first time running for public office, so I'm not in anybody's pocket.
Thank you, Marianne. Next speaker is another person who is challenging the existing commissioners, Kathy Bogarski.
Thank you very much, Alderman. Thanks, everybody, for being here. I want to say two things before I go into the issues. Number one is, I think this is an amazing day. Only in America, really, can you have such a diverse group all getting together, sitting down, listening to people speak, having a meal. We have Christians, Muslims, Jews, Indians, Pakistanis, whites, Catholics, Protestants, all together, all being cordial to one another. And I think that's a testament to how great this country is. I really do. Secondly, I want to say that my opponents are extremely qualified, and I get along with all of them. They've been nothing but cordial to me, and I've had actually a great time debating with them, discussing the issues with them, and I really don't have anything against any of my opponents. Like I said, I really do feel like this is one of those races where no matter who wins, you guys are going to have qualified commissioners in there. Salman said that one of the agendas here was for us to discuss what issues affect Muslim Americans from the Water Reclamation District, and I thought really hard about this, and what I came up with was that the issues that affect Muslim Americans are the same issues that affect everybody. And there's really three big things that I want to touch on. Number one is flooding. Number two is pollution. And last but definitely not least is taxes. I want to highlight each one. Flooding, first of all, costs on average $31 million to the district just on infrastructure. $31 million a year. That does not include lost revenue to businesses when they're closed down. That does not include artificially high insurance premiums. And that also does not include the eventuality of lowering the property values on houses and properties that are near the rivers where the flooding takes place. So I want to do something about that. I want to increase green construction, permeable surfaces, and wetlands. As far as pollution is concerned, I can sit up here and talk for 2 or 3 hours about pollution in Illinois, but I'm not going to do that. One of the big things I'm concerned about is what happens to prescription drugs after they're expired. A lot of people just throw them in the garbage or they flush them down the toilet. There's not a place where people can take their drugs currently that's convenient to have them disposed of properly. I want to work with and partner with pharmacies all throughout the county to make sure people know where they can take their drugs and they can take them there safely for disposal. Finally is taxes. You're not going to hear a lot about that with the Water Reclamation District. The reason is they're relatively efficient compared to other government agencies. But that does not mean they should be let off the hook. A $1.3 billion budget. What my job at Kraft Foods is, my full-time job at Kraft Foods is I'm the Continuous Improvement Project Manager. And Kraft Foods is a pretty lean private company. Okay, we do about $34 billion a year in revenue. Every single year, I have to, on top of inflation, I have to decrease our budget every single year in distribution. If I can do that in a private company, I know I can do it in a public agency. One question I have, and this is just a brief look at the budget. One question I have is, and this isn't going to save us millions of dollars, but it's a good example of, are we being true stewards of the taxpayer dollars? The 9 Water Reclamation Commissioners currently all get cars on the taxpayer dollar. Some of the commissioners only go to meetings twice a month. Is that really a wise use of taxpayer dollars, allowing them to have government cars? What I would suggest, and I would lead by example if elected, I would not take a car on the taxpayer dime. I would write off the mileage that I use for all the meetings I go to and all the visits, and that would be it. We would save a minimal amount of money, but it would be setting an example for the rest of the commission to act more efficiently. Be stewards of the taxpayer dollars. Even if it's nickels and dimes, it adds up and it sends the right message that we're not at the public's expense. We can't just raise taxes when you have issues. Find efficiencies. Think of the taxpayers. Think of the environment. I'll cut it there. I didn't get a chance to go on any credentials, but I do have literature on the tables if you do have any questions.
The next one we'll call upon is an incumbent commissioner, Commissioner Frank Avila.
Thank you very much. My name is Commissioner Frank Avila, and you know I'm a commissioner at the Metropolitan Water Reclamation District of Greater Chicago. And you know it's a great honor to be here today with the Muslims. This morning I was with three black churches, and I heard three good speeches. And here my fourth speech here on the sermon was the Quran. You know, at the district, what we do at the district is that we treat what you put in your mouth. You can put good food in your mouth, bad food in your mouth, and that's what we treat. But what comes out of your mouth is what the Quran preaches. And so it was a pleasure to hear the prayer of the Quran. But let me talk about the district. The district budget is $1.4 billion. And I am the chairman of the Maintenance and Operation Committee and the Engineering Committee. Out of that $1.4 billion, my two committees take in over $900 million. We take in over two-thirds of that budget. Because what we do at the district, the main thing that we do at the district is that we treat wastewater. What's wastewater? Everyone here in this room, we need a lot of things in our life, but we need to do two things. We need to eat and drink, and we need to go to the washroom. And that's what basic thing of what we do at the district. We have 7 sewer treatment plants at the district. We could treat up to over 2.4 billion gallons of wastewater a day. And we own one of the largest wastewater plants in the world, that's Stickney. It could treat up to 1.4 billion gallons of wastewater a day. We are going to upgrade 3 of the largest wastewater plants in North America. And one of them is the largest in the world. And my background is I have a Bachelor of Science in Civil Engineering and a Master's in Finance. I have been practicing engineering for 46 years. And I did flood studies, I designed sewers, roads, bridges. I understand the function of what we do in the district. Let's talk about civil rights. I own an engineering company for over 30 years, Avalon Associates, Inc. I had 80 employees. 40 of the 80 employees were Muslims. They came to me. They did not have a H-1 card. I hired them, and I helped them get their H-1 card. I had a very successful engineering company because most of the Muslims in the community were all engineers. We all went to school to become a civil engineer, mechanical engineer, electrical engineer. I identified with the Muslim, and when I was running, they did not think I was a Mexican American. They thought I was a Muslim. Because even when I go to Mexico, they don't think I'm Mexican. They think that I'm a Muslim. At the district, we have just passed an affirmative action program. We have beefed up our affirmative action program to make sure that we have minorities doing employment and contracts at the district. We talk about flooding. They talk about flooding. We own the deep tunnel. Our deep tunnel holes could hold about 2.3 billion gallons of stormwater wastewater. Now, we're going to complete, we have three reservoirs. One's completed, we're going to complete two more. We're going to complete McCook and Thorne Reservoir. Once that completed, that's going to hold 18 billion gallons of wastewater. 18 billion gallons. The only problem we have is that we were supposed to get federal dollars, but because of the war that's going on, they're not giving us the federal dollars, so we have to rely on the residents of Cook County to pay for the reservoirs of Cook County, of McCook and Thorne, and hopefully the federal government will pay us back the dollars. And that's why we need Congressman Chakowsky to make sure that the federal government will pay us back the dollars. Here's the Democratic president. So, you know, at the district, we do what? We treat wastewater, which is a major function of what we do at the district, because we need to treat our wastewater. We protect our water supply, which is Lake Michigan, because, as I mentioned, we need water. We try and manage flooding. We just took over stormwater management. I was one of the commissioners to help pass that law in the Springfield. The governor vetoed it. The governor Mogovich didn't want. He stopped it.
Question from the board.
Mr.
Avila,
you are one of the few people who are here, with the exception of Honorable Jan Chakowsky, who have been a constant recipient of the AMT endorsement. My question to you is, as a consumer, if I look at my water bill and sewer bill, I see in the past 2 years about 40, at least 40+% increase. Could you shed some light on it? And this question I'm asking you because you are incumbent, and I will ask every incumbent to address that question. Why, is that capital expense, or what is going on that for a consumer the price is that right? The service charge has went up at least 40+% in the past year.
The question is that why did we increase our real estate taxes? We did not. Our taxes went down. Go check your real estate tax bill. And then you compare it to 1996 tax bill to your 1995, you find that it went down. We did not increase. We're the only agency in the state that runs a very efficient agency.
My question is water and sewer,
not the... Our agency only treats wastewater. We're at the bottom end. We're not at the top end where you drink. We work at the bottom. When you flush your toilet, we treat wastewater. That's what we do. We don't take care of drinking water.
Thank you very much. Give her a big hand, Congresswoman Jane Chakowsky.
Was elected to represent Illinois 9th Congressional District on November 3rd, 1998,
after serving for 8 years in the Illinois State Assembly. She is in her fifth term. Ms. Chakowsky was recently appointed by Speaker Pelosi to serve in the House Select Committee on Intelligence. She opposes the Iraq War resolutions and was a founding member of the Out of Iraq Caucus. Throughout her career, she has fought for economic and social justice and an improvement for the quality of life for all. It is my honor for her to be here today.
Thank you very much for the privilege of being here and the privilege of working with your community, which of course is part of the an essential part of the 9th Congressional District. Some of you may remember on right after 9/11, the weekend after 9/11, I called for a solidarity walk down Devon Avenue where all of us, Jews and Christians and Muslims and whoever, would walk together down Devon Avenue and express our solidarity. Remember when Larry Sufferin and a number of the elected officials here were part of that walk down Devon Avenue to say that we are a community proud of our diversity. We are united as Americans here, and we're not going to allow ourselves to be separated by this tragedy, by terrorists, not associated with a religion necessarily, but other people who would try and destroy the United States of America. We're going to stand together, arm in arm. And since then, there have been a lot of incidents, including the issue of Guantanamo Bay. I went there about a month ago now, again. There are about 350 people there at Guantanamo Bay who are going into their sixth year of incarceration, who have never had due process of law. Never. There are people around the world, we now know, who are being interrogated. And by the way, Nancy Pelosi at the beginning of the session asked me if I would serve my country on the Intelligence Committee. So many of the things that are now coming out are things that I've gotten a whiff of, but not this issue of the tapes that were made using enhanced interrogation techniques, which I would call torture, and that are being used against people. We are not going to let this thing get slipped under the rug, as the new Attorney General has said in this case. I'm going to tell you one other story. I went as a new member of the Intelligence Committee. I was invited to the CIA for what you'd call kind of a charm offensive. They had me come out there, served me a beautiful lunch, and briefed me on anything I wanted to be briefed on. And at lunchtime, I handed the deputy director of the CIA a list of names, all of them being Middle Eastern names, of people whose whereabouts were unknown by Human Rights Watch and by the rest of the world, but thought to be known by officials of the United States of America. And when I handed him this list, I said, you know, I went to China several years ago, and I spoke to Zhang Zemin, who was at that time the premier of China, and I said to him, I gave him a list of names of people that the United States of America thought were improperly incarcerated, people of different religions, mostly. And I said to the deputy director of the CIA, never did I think in my lifetime I would come to my government with a list of names of people that we don't know where, nobody knows where they are. Because the United States of America does not disappear people. That is not who we are as a country. And we do not torture people. And we don't take them to undisclosed locations and do things to them that we would be, that we would never tolerate other people doing to us as Americans. What has this country come to? We are ready for a change, and I'm proud to serve now on the Intelligence Committee. Well, we passed on the conference committee that I was on an amendment that said the United States of America can only use interrogation techniques as approved by the Army Field Manual, and cannot torture people any longer. And we pass that. Let me end with this, because it all comes back home here. We have people on FBI lists who are waiting to get their citizenship, but because their name is like perhaps some other name, Mohammed, they can't, for example, they can't get their citizenship. They've done everything. They've passed the test. They're just waiting now to be called. Our office has intervened a number of times. We've helped some people. We presented a list of 150 names. We are following up on that. So the FBI name checks is something that we're working on. In addition, we are very concerned about people being stopped at the airport. And if you are one of those, or you would, some people in your family are among those, we can help you with that, because there is clearly profiling going on and people who have no business, citizens of this country, who are being stopped. So there's a whole raft of legislation that's being considered right now that I'm working on. You know, I voted against the USA Patriot Act because I thought that it was an act that discriminated against people, that allowed for spying into the lives of ordinary Americans, not just in the Muslim community, but all of us. And so the civil rights legislation is at the top of my agenda. I have appreciated in the past the endorsement of this organization. It would mean very, very much to me. But regardless, I want you to know that I will continue to work in partnership with this community because it has meant so much to the strength of our entire district. Thank you very much.
It looks like the room is filling up. It must mean that hopefully the snow is melting outside. That's just a wishful thought. The next person I'd like to introduce to you has been a great friend to the Muslim community. He's running for Democratic challenger for the 9th Congressional District. His name is John Yoseda. John's objective is to bring a sense of cohesion to the House of Representatives, to cut lines and encourage all members to work for the people, regardless of political affiliation. The issue John believes will be critical in the coming election, including war, illegal immigration, and security and retirement benefits and Social Security, the rising cost of energy and the housing market. I'm so happy that he's here. We're honored for him to be here today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm honored to have been asked to speak here today. Let me introduce myself. John Yoseda. I'm 44 years old. As you know, I'm running in the 9th Congressional District. I've been married for 10 years to my wife, Rose. We have 4 children. They attend private school, where not only they receive a fine education, they receive religious education as well. I think that's important. I, like many people in this room, worry about the day-to-day issues of life. Yes, I worry about the soldiers in Iraq and Afghanistan, but I also worry about paying the mortgage. I worry about paying energy bills. Health insurance is very prohibitive to my family and to my business. I run a small business. I've been a lawyer for 15 years. I've helped a lot of people in my time in many different issues. I'm here today to ask, can anyone here say that we're better off today than we were 5 to 10 years ago? And I then ask, how did our country develop all these serious problems and issues? And with our vast resources and talent available, why can't we solve them? I can't possibly address all the issues and come up with solutions one by one in a short time frame here. But I know everyone here understands what they are. The question is, why doesn't Congress solve these issues? I believe the answer is, unlike the people of the 9th District, where we're very diverse, we have different ethnicities, religions, and even races, we find a way to work together. We find a way to go to do our business together. We find a way to be good neighbors and raise our families. The problem is Congress is polarized and divisive. Thus, they become ineffective. Why is Congress unable to pass legislation that's necessary? Because the leadership of Congress is led by liberals, left-wing liberals, and the Republicans pretty much are led by the far right-wing conservatives. When you start from these two points, it would be very difficult to reach consensus on anything. Thus, seldom do they reach any meaningful legislation. In 2006, the Americans gave power back to the Democrats and put them in power to make changes, to create reform. That has not occurred. It is now time to hold Congress accountable for this. The question now is, when, if ever, will Congress pass the legislation America needs? Well, I suspect that's up to the voters to decide. If the voters want change, they're going to elect women and men who represent their views. Reasonable people who use common sense can create legislation that a majority can support. I imagine a future where the members of Congress will work with the President for reform, to restore moral values, to revitalize our economy, and to renew the spirit and belief that people have in the American dream. If you are content with the status quo, the way things are today, then vote for the Washington politicians again. If you want a person with integrity, as I feel I have, and who will be accountable to the people, then I will be your voice in Congress. I've helped a lot of people as a lawyer, and I intend, if I became a public servant, to do more so. If you want to learn about my exact position on many issues, please view my website, johnlucidaforcongress.com. Thank you.
Same question I'm going to ask you about. If you become a congressman, what are you going to do about Afghanistan?
I don't have a lot of first-hand knowledge about what goes on in Afghanistan or anywhere for that matter. But if we're going to bring our troops home, if we're going to achieve the stability we need in the region, we have to trust our leaders who are out there, the generals, the people involved. I would certainly be willing to listen to them and the other members of Congress, Republicans, Democrats alike, and come up with a plan for exit strategy.
The next candidate that I'd like to introduce is the Democratic challenger for the 13th Congressional District. His name is Scott Harper. Please come to the stage. Thank you. Scott is running for Congressional District 13. He feels he is the best candidate since he's lived his whole life in this district. No neighborhood, right? Mr. Harper is a successful entrepreneur. He will work hard in the Congress to support small business and encourage new enterprise. He believes in strengthening the middle class, protecting the environment, and supporting innovation.
Thank you. I'm going to try to lighten this up a tiny bit. Instead of describing myself, I'm going to tell a little story. This was the second trip I had been to a Muslim country. I'd previously been to Palestine. But I took a trip to Egypt. And the basic plan of the trip was to make a big triangle from Cairo to Hurghada to Luxor and back to Cairo along the Nile. So after many interesting adventures going through the desert, we're about 200 miles from Cairo traveling north, and the car breaks down. So what did we do? It was a flat tire, so there was a tire fixing place right down the road. We went back to fix the tire, came back to the car, and what did we find? The battery was missing. Now, we had already been treated to the hospitality of strangers that's mandated in the Quran twice, once with a clogged fuel filter, and another time when we ran out of gas. and somebody actually siphoned the gas with their mouth from their car into our rental car. So I knew not to, you know, this wasn't a Muslim thing, this was just somebody needed a battery worse than we did. So instead of blaming anybody, we thought, what can we do? So we hitchhiked to Cairo, 200 miles. How do we do it? We hopped on top of a millet truck. And this is one of my best experiences ever of travel. Hopped on top of that millet truck. The fresh grain was wafting into our noses. Got to Egypt through the night, beautiful starry sky. Fish and pool from the street vendors in Cairo. Somehow found a party, and then Sunday morning found a battery, took a taxi back to where our car was located and broken down. Now, what does any of this have to do with running for Congress or the problems in the Middle East? Well, it's this. I am not somebody who just stays on the sidelines, not some academic who looks at problems. I'm somebody who gets in there, looks at people, deals with people as they are. I know that the Muslim community is very moderate, very modest, has people who are working for a living to make a better life for their children, just like all of us. I'm outraged at the way we lump people together and have pursued disastrous policies in the Middle East on the completely bogus theory that somebody in rural Afghanistan had something to do with Saddam Hussein. So I'm in favor of getting our troops out of Iraq as quickly as possible. On the domestic front, I'm running on fiscal responsibility, ending corporate tax breaks that are increasing the taxes on the middle class. And thirdly, I'm running on a clean environment, clean water, clean air, and a green future. Thank you.
Cook County Recorder of Deeds. We have incumbent and challenger both here. So we will invite the incumbent, Mr. Eugene Moore.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here with the Muslim community. I just want to take the opportunity to thank you each and every one of you for being here. My name is Eugene Moore. I am the current Cook County Recorder of Deeds, and I'm looking forward to becoming, again, the Recorder of Deeds. Set by state statute, the recorder's mission is to record, store, and retrieve information for public use. That is our opportunity, that is my resource, and that's what we do as the Cook County Recorder of Deeds. We record property. As the Recorder of Deeds, when I took over the Recorder of Deeds office, it was on a manual format. And we brought the recorders up to an automatic format. It's totally automated at the present time. We're looking forward to continue to automate the office. We did a bag data conversion when I first got started from 85 forward, a bag data conversion. Everything is now on a computerized format as well as a digital format. In regards to recording of all properties. We did also a track book, which is basically what we did was which is the grantor grantee books. We restored all those books back to the Chicago Fire, which began in, as they say, 1871. So we brought everything up for it. We actually hired 40 people from the community to start that job and to complete that job as well. So we're constantly looking forward to automate the office, completely going back into the 21st century, going up to the 21st century. We want to continue to do that. We're looking forward now to do another bag data conversion to 70, to 1970. As a matter of fact, that project will be completed in 08, around August of 08. We will be going back to 1970. So we want to continue to put the office into the 21st century. We want to continue to record all your property in Cook County. As a matter of fact, like I stated before, that's what we do. We currently record approximately 4,000 documents a day. We're looking forward to continuing to do that service. We are projected to earn or to collect $67 million this year in the recorder's office. Normally, with the advent of the low market rate currently, we normally would be collecting pretty close to $85 million.
But with that going on, with the depressed economy, we're looking forward to trying to keep things moving forward as best we can so that we can help the county government. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you. If you have any questions, we would certainly be glad to answer those for you.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. I have a question. Since you've been in the office for almost 8 or 9 years, have you ever thought about hiring Muslims in your office?
Yes. Yes, we have a cross-section of group, ethnic groups in our office. We're working there with them now. We have Indians as well as Muslims working currently in the office. We're looking forward to continue to do that as well. Because that's what we have, a cross-section of office. We have 220 people, employees that work for us. And basically, it is a great diverse group. We're looking to continue to do that as well.
Great, thank you. Please make it quick.
We do have as we have the report, especially in African-American communities, and also across the border, those elderly who might be suffering with Alzheimer's, maybe the people, those elderly who may not have any caretakers, and they are also being foreclosed, you know, because of the back taxes. You know, is there any effort, any program you can suggest that we can look after to make sure that just because maybe $500, $1,000, the taxes were not paid and the elderly people will not suffer, their houses are not foreclosed, and these things have happened in the past.
Within the foreclosure, Mark, we realize that's a major problem going on currently, the foreclosure. However, my office is not the office that deals with the foreclosure, the taxes, and things of that type. What we do is actually record all that information. However, we are working at seeing how we can help the people who are losing their properties with the illegal conveyances of property. People in the community with the warranty deeds, people are actually going out and removing or stealing people's property. Right? Quit claiming the deeds over to someone else in the community or the mortgage companies that are working with other groups.
My question is pertaining to the communication to make sure that this thing was communicated to those elderly. Because in many cases, and I'm aware of some of the cases, where elderly, the people who were sick, where they were in the home, they never realized there was a notice on them, you know, and it was recorded. So is there any effort in maybe your office can do something to make sure that these back taxes are communicated with elderly owners, especially the senior members?
Well, basically what we try to do is bring the information to the public. With our website, CCRD, well, people can look on that website and see exactly what is actually happening with their property. By doing that, from your home, from your library, or from anywhere, even in your kitchen, you can use the computer to look at those. But those folks who are elderly don't have that opportunity. They have to bring their family members over to help them search those properties. So that's what we can do for them. It is currently involved right now where you can actually look those records up right from your house to help your family member out.
Thank you very much, Mr. Moore. Now I will invite Alderman Smith, Alderman Ed Smith. I will request him to speak English, not Hindi and Urdu, since he speaks Hindi and Urdu very fluent.
Just a couple of words, okay? Namaskar, Amandi. He needs Tora Tora. Yeah, tell me five words. My name is Ed Smith, and I want to come back to your question when we go through this to speak on it. But I'm a candidate for the Cook County Court of Deeds. And I've been in independent politics on the west side of Chicago for many years. I was one of the people who worked to organize the Hail Washington campaign and subsequently went to the city council where I passed the smoking ban along with members of the city council. And I intend to take that same vigilance into the recorder's office. Now, this race, and I want everybody to understand this, is about who can you trust? That's the crux of the race. Who can you trust? the integrity of the office is the main crux of the campaign. Who can you trust? Now, we can talk about the mission for the office, and I've got a mission. I don't want to get into all that. I want to create a management system. I want to create a mission for the office and modernize the office. That's what we're going to do. That's a part of the initial thing that we're going to do. It's a multiplicity thing we're going to do, but that's the initial thing that we're going to do. But in the final analysis, we have to deal with that patronage system that exists in that office. It is a dumping ground for precinct workers. Now, don't get me wrong. I believe that people ought to have jobs. But if you do not have the cognitive skill to do a job, you should not be dumped in Recorder D's office to suck up the taxpayers' money and do nothing. That day is over. We are going to change the mode of operation in that office. That's the first step. Now, let me respond to your question. Your question was, what do you do about the foreclosures? If you look at television tonight, Fox News, there were several other cameras there. We dealt with the foreclosures again today. Now, we've been dealing with foreclosures for about the last 3 months. Really, been on it because it's a major problem in the city of Chicago, the county of Cook, and the state of Illinois. Major problem. Congressman Danny Davis, Reverend Jesse Jackson, Mayor of the City of Chicago, the Governor's Office, we're all dealing with this foreclosure. Some of the things we're asking people to do, these people that have let this money out, either banks, mortgage companies, we're saying to them, there are several things that you can do. Because you're going to end up with all of these houses that are closing, you're going to end up with them. First of all, you can cut their payments. If their payments are for 30 years, you can send it out to 40 years to allow them to continuously to own their house. The other thing you can do, you don't have to put people out. If people just can't make it, let them stay in the house for 6 months to try to find a way to deal with it. Let them pay rent. Don't throw them out. And then you can get other agencies who have been working with people across the board. There are some not-for-profits who might give these people some help. So we are trying our best to deal with it because it's a major problem in the city of Chicago. And the only thing that most people have to pass on to their children, prosperity they call it, is their home. If they lose their home, the house, it's all gone, it's over. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alderman. I'd like to introduce Judge Alan Griman. He's been the Chief Justice, Chief Judge of the Illinois Appellate Court for the last 16 years. It's our honor to have you here today. Thank you.
Thank you for letting me come. Thank you for letting me speak. As she said, I've been the Chief Judge of the Illinois Appellate Court actually for 11, but I've been on the court for 16 years. And I have to run for election, which is okay. This was a great, great year for me so far. Firstly, I was found highly qualified by the Chicago Bar Association, something they rarely do. Usually just say qualified, but they found me highly qualified. And then I was unanimously nominated by the Democratic Party for every committee, which was also very nice for me. In my term as Chief Judge, my term as Chief Judge, I've changed the culture of the court. Changed the culture so that decisions are made in a timely way. The appellate court is the middle court. There's the Supreme Court and there's the lower court. And judges don't necessarily know how to become appellate court judges. So I instituted training for judges, for new judges. And finally, I set up a settlement committee so they could all come and settle and agree. I'm thinking we can save some money. And just to finish, I'll tell you a brief story about people. I've done 1,000 decisions. People say, Alan, what's the best decision you've done? And I say, well, my best decision is my worst decision. How can that be? Young kid, high school, inner city, chess team, basketball team, wants to go to college, survived a druggy mother. He's walking to school one day, and the guy says, hey, Want to buy a firecracker? Okay, he buys the firecracker. He lights it and puts it in the locker. Lights it. Boom. Boom. They call the police. He's charged with aggravated arson. Aggravated arson carries a prison sentence mandatory of 7 years. He's convicted. Case comes to me. Well, is he guilty of that technically? Well, maybe he is, maybe he isn't, but probably he's been guilty. So then I write the worst decision. Now I know, by the way, that if he's a kid from New Trier, from Oak Brook, from Flossmore, daddy's going to come with a lawyer the next day, a check for $500, they're going to give it to the school, they'll put her on probation for a month, goodbye, the end of the story. But instead, he's convicted and comes to me. And I write the worst decision of my career. You know why? Because this kid had to get out. He had to have justice. And I had to choose between that conviction and justice. And I chose justice, and he walked out free. So that's what I do. I do justice. Thank you. Experience comes.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
The next judge I would like to introduce to you is Cook County Circuit Judge Honorable Jesse Reyes.
Judge Reyes is also a president of the Cook County Judge Association.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Jesse Reyes, and I am running countywide for the Francis Golaki vacancy. I'm an endorsed Democratic candidate for that vacancy. And to get back to the original question, honesty and competency. Judges and judicial candidates have to always submit themselves to bar evaluations. I've been an associate judge for the past 10 years, and repeatedly the bar associations have found me to be honest and to be competent, to be highly professional, and also what I bring to this position is diversity. In fact, I am part of one of the most diverse slate of judicial candidates that the Democratic Party has put together in recent history. We had to go through a special screening session with regards to Alderman Pertwinkle's subcommittee. And the questions were put to us, not only about our qualifications, but what have we done with regards to the community? What have we done for the people? And I'm proud to say that I passed the muster to that committee and then went before the Democratic Party for further slating. What I want to continue to say is with regards to the people. After 5 o'clock, when I take the robot, I do not stop working for the people. I'm out in the community, doing work, to help the people. So my slogan for you, and what I want you to go away with, knowing about me, is that I am not only reflective of the community, but I am for the community. And I would ask for your endorsement for Circuit Court Judge on February 5th, 2008. Thank you very much.
Now, we have about 5 candidates for State Attorney's Office. I would like to, before I bring them in, I would like Frank Avila Jr. to come here and say a few words. Frank Avila Jr. is he is a producer of the TV, the CAN TV show. We're going to put the whole thing. And it's awesome. There are 5 candidates first here.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Thank you very much, Sal. I call him Sal because sometimes people were saying Salman. He says, look, it's Salman. He says, not the fish. And we're just talking about name changes and how difficult things are in this country. We're talking with Commissioner Sufford and how at one time many people changed their names and how great it is that Salman could be Salman here and all of us could be here, whether it be Mohammed or whatever it is, and to keep those names. No person besides Sal Aftab has bridged the gulf between, especially after 9/11, being on TV shows, being in the media, running for office, than Sal Aftab. Nobody. And he deserves a round of applause. And besides the people here, this will also be on at least our cable show, and I guess some other cable shows, which is on Google Video and YouTube, and also Cable Access Network. But I want to tell you, in 2004, I think we were just down the street a block, and Sal Aftab, Jan Schakowsky, and myself were then State Senator Barack Obama. And the Sheik was there, and he gave a prayer, and he gave a talk about how the people chose Moses. And I don't want to mess the talk up, but there was a talk about wisdom and how you choose political representation. And Sal Aftab and Congressman Schakowsky and myself all worked in 2004 with Barack Obama, who was on my cable show numbers of times. In fact, you can see some of the old ones on Google Video and YouTube. And Sal Aftab went up against another Muslim group on the South Side, which is very venerable and a good group, but they were Dan Hines, because that was the establishment candidate. And Sal Aftab said, I'm not going to go with the establishment. I'm going to break the establishment. I'm going to go with Barack Obama. And many of you in this room today went with Barack Obama, and now you're making history again because he's running for president. So the North Side Muslim community, the Indian and Pakistani community, and Sal Aftab were with Barack Obama, and you made history, and you deserve a lot of credit. And I remember, because we're just one block away, I think it was a restaurant on the left, I don't remember the name.
Sultan.
And I was invited by him. When my father ran in 2002 and made history, being the only Hispanic running countywide at large. And now there's a movement by many people who claim to be for diversity who are excluding the only Hispanic. You were there for my father in 2002. And on the Water Reclamation District, and then I'll do the introduction. The Water Reclamation District, people talk about terrorism. The most Muslim, Indian, Arab, Pakistani employees are the Water Reclamation District protecting all of our wastewater. And there's been not one single incident of terrorism. So all the engineers, all the technicians, the scientists, and the chemists were there. And Sal Aftab ran for office, and somebody said, oh, well, a Muslim can't win. And he said, oh, you shouldn't go with him. My father and myself endorsed Sal Aftab in the primary. And we were with him, not because we thought necessarily he would win, because we realized it was an uphill battle to break that glass ceiling so the next time somebody runs for office who's Indian or Muslim, just like the first time my father ran and lost, by the third time he won so we could have Hispanics, the only Hispanic. And you have to unite because there's really some very devious moves going around to not allow the only Hispanic countywide, and we're going to reveal some of those, and to hurt your community. But the state's attorney's office is the prosecutor. So if you get in trouble, and some of you could, or if you've been a victim of a crime, the state's attorney's office, the prosecutor, is, and you had state's attorney Devine, who was elected in 1996, and there are at least one Republican, Commissioner Tony Perica, who I know Sal Aftab supported for county board president, and there I said I think he made the right choice on that one, for the county board president. But now it's a different race. We have Anita Alvarez, who is somebody I look up to. I'm a little bit younger than she is. You might not like me saying that, but it's true nonetheless. And she's a great prosecutor, and she's a fellow Latina, and she is has a great deal of experience. A very dear friend of mine, Howard Brookins, who's been a longtime friend of the Avila family. I see Senator Brookins, who my father sold his first funeral home to him before I think either Howard or I were born. Tommy Brewer, and him and I have been on some cases together. Commissioner Larry Suffredin, and we've discussed many cases. He's done cases like I have in terms of civil rights. So really some great qualifications and some great credentials. And you should listen to all of them. I don't know what order. I guess Anita Alvarez was here first. So she deserves, I guess, to go first, and I think we're going to, I guess, in some quasi-alphabetical order. So Anita Alvarez, who I believe has been at the state's attorney's office the longest time out of any of the candidates. There's another candidate who's been there. How many years? 21 years at the state's attorney's office. And she's currently at the state's attorney's office, I believe, in the top three positions. In the top three positions at the state's attorney's office. Please welcome attorney and prosecutor Anita Alvarez.
I'm not going to tell you my age, okay?
But my name is Anita Alvarez. I'm suffering from a little cold, so excuse me. And I am running for Cook County State's Attorney. I have been in the office for 21 years. I have spent my entire legal career speaking on behalf of the victims of Cook County. And the reason that I never left this office is because of the passion that I have to serve the victims of Cook County. I am their voice in court, and I know my victims look like you, they look like me, my victims are a minority, and that's whose voice I am when I go into court every day, when I put my name on the record, Anita Alvarez, on behalf of the people of the state of Illinois. I am seeking this position because I believe that I am the most qualified for this position. I started in the office just like everybody else on the bottom and worked my way up to the top. I presently serve as third in command of the second largest prosecutor's office in the nation. Again, I have a passion for this job that I don't believe any of my opponents have. I have supervised the Public Integrity Unit, Deputy Bureau Chief of the Narcotics Unit, Bureau Chief of the Special Prosecutions Unit, before attaining my present title. So I've handled every type of case, but probably the most famous case that you have heard of, and that is the case of the Girl X case, the little girl in Cabrini Green who was brutally raped and left for dead. That case was mine, and it was an honor to represent her in court, to put her on the stand, and to fight for justice in that case. I have tried, handled everything from police corruption cases, and I am the only candidate up here that can stand up here and tell you that they personally prosecuted police officers and convicted them in court. Now, I have a lot of good friends who are police officers, and I work hand in hand with them every day, and I have a lot of respect for what they do, and we all know that there's good and bad apples in every bunch. But I'm not afraid of those types of cases. I'm not afraid of tackling corruption. I'm not afraid of handling them, and I've proven that I can do it. I also have some ideas for this office. This office is not perfect, and I stand up here, a 21-year veteran of that office, and I admit that to you. There are things that we can do better, and I would like to do those things in this office. I'd like to bring back the community prosecution's offices that we had to close in regard because of the budget cuts that we incurred. But I would love to bring those community prosecution's offices back because I think they're important to every community. And there should be one up here. There should be one in every community because it allows us to put a face to a name, so to speak. It allows us to really, really be more involved in the community because I think one of the problems that we're facing every day is that the distrust that we have of law enforcement in many communities, and particularly minority communities, and we have to tackle that. And I am ready, willing, and able to do that. And I think bringing back my community prosecution's offices to every neighborhood and expanding, that I'd be able to do that and do that more vigorously. I also have some ideas on identity theft, which is a big problem, obviously, that we have seen nationwide. And right now we have a consumer fraud unit that handles it, but there's really only two people in there that handle those types of cases. So I think it's more important for the community at large to have something like identity theft unit, a separate unit, so we can concentrate on those particular things. I know that we're running out of time, but I offer you a steady leadership for a positive change. I am the only woman in this race. The only Hispanic, no woman has ever run for Cook County State's Attorney, and no woman has ever been Cook County State's Attorney. But again, I dispel the myth that you have to be a man to do this job, because I can be just as tough as anybody in court, yet I think I have the sensitivity, and I am an awesome listener, and I will listen to the needs of every community. Thank you.
Thank you, Anita Alvarez. I've been asked by the board here that if all the state's attorneys candidates could wait, I know that and this is on both ethnic TV and cable access network and the internet, to postpone questions for all the candidates. So if all could stay in, then he could ask all the questions at the same time in the interest of time. I'd like to bring up Tommy Brewer next.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Tommy Brewer by way of background. I'm a native Chicagoan, product of Chicago Public Schools and Chicago Public Housing. Graduate of Williams College, Northwestern School of Law. Had 10 years in the office of the Special Agent of the FBI. Did public corruption and white collar crime. I'm a former assistant state's attorney. I was supervising the gang prosecution unit. Also worked in the Civil Rights Division of the Massachusetts Attorney General's Office, as well as the Medicaid Fraud Control Unit. For the past 12 years, I've been doing criminal defense work. And during this time, I was appointed assistant special prosecutor in the John Birch investigation. To me, diversity should be not just tolerated, but celebrated. That's the way I've always believed, born African American here in this country. I just believe that. Also, during my tenure as Attorney General's office. I worked in the Civil Rights Division. And my first day on the job, we had some Cambodian immigrants who burned out. It was a main television that day. And just listen to the immigrants from Cambodia and Vietnam explaining the reason they had come to this country, looking for a better life. And they just wanted Americans to understand that they wanted the same thing that Americans were enjoying. And that really touched me even deeper and made me more firmly convinced that certainly diversity should be celebrated, not just tolerated. And as the next state's attorney, that will be my objective in terms of the policies of that office, the hiring practice, promotion practice, and also the sensitivity to every community in this county, because I think that it is extremely, extremely important that we have that. And let me just say this. I think the Bill of Rights is a very, very good thing. I think the founding fathers knew exactly what they were doing when they made the Bill of Rights. And the Bill of Rights, in my opinion, are not just for Americans. The Bill of Rights is good for everybody. And anything that the Americans touch, any person, whether they're immigrants, citizens or not, if their rights are going to be abridged in any significant way, they should have due process. It's not an American thing. I mean, thing for Americans is just the American way, in my opinion. And so in this office, I will fight to protect the rights of anyone who's on the auspices of the United States in any way and is have their rights abridged, that they will be entitled to the same rights we enjoy as Americans. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Brewer. Before I introduce the next guest, Mr. Brewer mentioned something that I want to say that's important to your community, because you mentioned torture. And as many of you know, as I'm an attorney for Aaron Patterson, who was a person who was a criminal, he had a criminal life, but he was tortured. And some of the people who were tortured had their testicles electrocuted. And one community that stood with us to try to reveal this torture, some of them were in jail and death row for crimes they did not commit for almost 20 years. They were bagged, suffocated, beat, deprived. I mean, horrible, horrible things. And it didn't happen in the context of war. Not that that's justified either. It happened in the context of the United States of America, the city of Chicago, Chicago police, and the evidence is overwhelming. Reports, OPS reports, federal investigations, and the civil lawsuit. And Sal Aftab, again, stood with me, and so did so many Muslim groups, because my client had converted to Islam. I did not. I know Bernie Stone did. I did not, though. I'm still Catholic, but Bernie Stone did. My client did, and so many groups helped him, so he could get out of a criminal life, and he could delve into his own issues of spirituality. And he had suffered immensely, and has immense psychological issues because of that. The next person I'm going to introduce is someone with the City Council, along with Alderman Smith, who was here earlier, Alderman Brookins, and I also have to say Alderman Burke and Alderman Fioretti, were four of the people who helped settle this case. Because so few of the other aldermen really didn't know what the issues were on this case. And Alderman Brookins worked with me and the other plaintiff's lawyers, sometimes even getting in the middle of our disputes because the plaintiff's lawyers had some kind of contentious dispute. He was always fair, he's a good man and a good friend, and he helped resolve, didn't you see the $20 million in the papers? How Alderman Brookins helped resolve that issue with the city of Chicago and Birch torture. And that affects here because torture has happened in the United States. It's been rare. But it has happened, primarily with African-American males in a criminal context. And Alderman Brookins helped stop that. Alderman Brookins, the next step. Alderman Brookins.
Thank you, Frank. Trying to steal some of my speech. Abu Ghraib, Guantanamo Bay, Area 2 Police. With all due respect to Congressman Jan Schakowsky, rendition and torture exist here, Cook County, City of Chicago, and the Cook County State Department of Justice is not going to die. Rendition exists when, as criminal defense attorneys, somebody is arrested, and you call a police station and you ask, "Is my client there?" And they give you the runaround, transferring you to location, from place to place, without telling you where your client is located. Torture exists when more than 200 African-American men and a 14-year-old boy who were tortured in such a way and 20 years before Abu Ghraib that would put Abu Ghraib and Guantanamo Bay to shame. Judge Grimen got up here and told a story about how he purposely did mental gymnastics to come with a just and fair outcome for a young man who was over-prosecuted. Well, the job of the prosecutor is to determine what gets charged, how it gets charged, and who gets charged. I submit to you, had I been a prosecutor, we would never get to that point where he would have had to tell that story. Because there has been an overreaching with respect to charges, and there hasn't been common sense with respect to the things that have been going on in Cook County. The Tribune has done tremendous exposés about the disparity of treatment between poor and minority defendants and others. It is widely documented. I don't have to tell anybody about racially profiling through airports, etc., because within the African-American community, there's nobody who's been above being racially profiled. Congressman Davis, just the other day, Senator Meeks, several years before that, I myself have been a victim of not only racially profiled, but been arrested by the Chicago police under some rules that they got a call that the cars were being stolen, and I'm sitting in my suit as an attorney, happened to fit the bill. You need someone in that office who is unafraid, unabashedly afraid to stand up and speak truth to power, who is able to stand up and say the unpopular thing at the unpopular time, but the time is right in speaking truth to power. More than 4 years ago, when this issue wasn't, oh, I prosecuted this many people, etc., I, with two of my colleagues in the city council, dared to propose the police accountability ordinance so that we can tell who these particular bad apples, these few bad apples in the police department were, to rid them from the police force where they're costing the county and the city tens of millions of dollars. But not only that, they have a whole community. Whole minority communities are distrusting of the whole criminal justice system because of these few bad apples. I've been practicing for 20 years. I've been a state's attorney. I've been a public defender. I've been a special assistant attorney general. I've been an assistant appellate prosecutor. We've all practiced law, but the question in this office is, does the person have the vision and the discipline to lead this office, to be fair for every person, no matter how unpopular it may be? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Alderman Hardwick. Next, I'd like to bring up Commissioner Larry Suffredin. Commissioner Larry Suffern, I know, has worked a lot with Sal Aftab and Congressman Jan Schakowsky. I think he represents some of these areas in the north suburbs and worked a lot with her community, and a good friend of Congressman Schakowsky, I believe endorsed by her, and works with Sal Aftab and many other groups here. Commissioner
Larry.
Commissioner Larry Suffern.
Yes.
Frank, I want to welcome you to the 13th District of the Cook County Board, also endorsed by Alderman Bernie Stone, whatever religion he has today. You know, in thinking about what to say to this group today, I want to go back to something Jan talked about. I helped her organize the march on Devon Avenue the weekend after 9/11. And I think from that moment on, I realized the importance of working with this Muslim community as a county board member. And I want to go through some things that we've been able to do at the county board. We made Cook County an immigrant-friendly county. We did that not as a symbolic gesture, as one of my colleagues, who you may hear from in a few minutes, will tell you, but we did it because it was important to make sure our sheriff's department and our state's attorney's department were not being used by the federal government to try to enforce immigration law against people who had done no wrong. So our purpose there was to make sure that that would not happen. And I assure you, if I become the state's attorney, we will not use the civil process or the criminal process of the state of Illinois to do immigration work for the federal government. Second thing is, I've been involved with this community in a lot of restorative justice issues and pushing to get bills passed in Springfield that give people a chance on small offenses to have the opportunity for greater opportunities to have these cases diverted and not prosecuted. Cases that oftentimes would have immigration implications to many of the people from this community. Finally, the status quo has got to change. This office is non-existent in most of the minority neighborhoods of this county. It does not provide a community-based justice system that gives confidence to the people of the Muslim community or any community that, in fact, justice happens here in Cook County. There are three things a state's attorney must have. It must be an independent person. My record on the county board of fighting the powers of the county shows I'm an independent person. It must be an experienced person. I've tried many, many cases. I've been to the U.S. Supreme Court. I've been to the Illinois Supreme Court. I know how to use the courts to protect the civil rights of the citizens of this county. But more importantly, it has to be somebody who's fair. We need to take on public corruption. Public corruption is what's destroying confidence in government at all levels. If I'm elected state's attorney, I assure you that your community will feel there is a sense of purpose and justice coming out of this office that has not existed in the time that you and your families have lived in Cook County. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Larry Sussman. And this is his district, so welcome to his district. This is also, I believe, the 50th ward of Alderman Bernard Stone, who was here earlier and did some emceeing earlier. He had a goal, that's why I took over for him. And I want to go back about a year ago when, oh, actually, let's go back for first 2 years ago that John Stroger, sadly, a good friend of many of us here, had gotten ill, and he was replaced with his son, Todd Stroger. And at that time, nobody thought a Republican could win, and Commissioner Tony Pareko ran for Cook County Board presidency, and nobody thought he would even get, you know, 10% of the vote. But he almost won. And one of the people, a Democrat who stood by Tony Pareko, was Sal Aftab in 2006. And he had taken many risks before, supporting Congressman Jan Schakowsky when you had billionaires running, supporting Barack Obama when the South Side Muslim groups went with Dan Hines, supporting my father when nobody was with him. Sal Aftab has done so many risks. He took another risk in 2006. And if I'm not mistaken, Tony Pareko won the 50th ward over Bernie Stone. And he had done very well in the Muslim community, and everybody has a connection here to the community. Howard Brookins, Tommy Brewer, Anita Alvarez, Larry Sufferton, because it's his district. But Sal Aftab said I should mention that Tony Pareko is the only one who's a member of your family, because his beautiful wife, Lilo, is Pakistani. and a Sunni Muslim. So Tony is the only member of your family here. Albeit through marriage. So I would like to, and then the next year, Tony Pareko endorsed Sal Aftab, the only Muslim American running for alderman anywhere in the city of Chicago. And Sal Aftab did not win, but he made history. And then what happened is Bernie Stone was in a runoff. And if it wasn't for Sal Aftab, Bernie Stone would not be the alderman today, because the margin of difference was the votes. Well, he got more votes, actually, than a margin of difference. That's how small the turnout was. If it wasn't for Sal Aftab, Bernie Stone would not be alderman today. And that's why Bernie Stone was here. Thank you, Sal Aftab, for winning the 50th ward, because Bernie Stone is a part of history. I mean, he's been in there for a long, long time. I remember when I was a kid, I saw Bernie Stone. And Bernie Stone had one more term to fulfill his history and one more victory, because of Sal Aftab and the Muslim and the Pakistani and Indian communities. Give yourselves a round of applause, and let's give Sal Aftab a round of applause. And Commissioner Tony Pareko, Republican candidate for Cook County State's Attorney.
Yeah, Republican candidate. Go.
Thank you. There's at least one Republican in the room.
God bless you. Thank you very much, friend. Frank, and all of you who are here today, assalamu alaikum to all. Good to be with you today. And to one other Republican, actually my wife is a Republican, so there's three of us in the room today. God love you all. My name is Tony Pareko, and I am running for Cook County State's Attorney. This is a very important office, and I think that the county residents are
privilege to have as many qualified, talented people running for this office. And I think there really isn't, in any other case, whether federal, state, or local, as many qualified, energetic, goal-oriented people who are going to give the taxpayers of Cook County quite a show as we go into November of 2008. Is that right, Senator? That's right. Well, I am running unopposed in the Republican primary because yesterday the Cook County Board of Elections confirmed that my opponent is going to be removed from the ballot because he could not get sufficient number of signatures, valid signatures that are required to be on the ballot. So he was removed by the Board of Election. We'll see if he files a lawsuit. I trust that he will know better and just walk away. But this particular office is extremely important. It is the chief law enforcement office in Cook County. And I am an immigrant, Commissioner Sufferin, so I know a little bit about being one. And my wife is an immigrant. Both of us came here. I came here in 1970. My wife came in 1974. I was orphaned at the age of 11. I had to pay and work through my way through high school, college, law school. I ran against the powers both within the Democratic Party, and then after I switched parties in 1994, became a Republican because I had an epiphany, and I couldn't be hypocritical anymore. I ran against the powers in the Republican Party, and I still am. If you want to talk truth to power, as Howard says, I am the candidate for this office, because I will take no nonsense from anybody on the Republican or Democratic side. And that's the attitude that I brought to the County Board of Commissioners, which were a collection of potted plants before them. In 2002, we caused a revolution on that board. And I and Commissioner Claypool went to federal court to sue former President John Stroger to establish that 15 votes are greater than 2. The other 15 commissioners apparently agreed that 2 votes are greater than 15. So I know how to stand up for the rights of the elected legislative members, and I know how to stand up for the rights of people, regardless of their ethnic background, color, religion, or anything else. I have represented many African Americans and Hispanic Americans in court for free when their civil rights were abused in Cicero, in Melrose Park, in Summit, and all these wonderful places which are part of my district, some of which parts are not as civilized as others up here on the north side of Cook County. So I know how to stand up with people and for people. I know how to fight the powers within the system that we have. This office is not only about enforcing the law as the state legislature gives it to us. And some of the members of the state's attorney's office talk about their prosecutorial experience. This office cuts the whole range of civil and criminal experience. And I've been a special prosecutor at the state appellate prosecutor's office. I've been working as an attorney for 25 years, been a mediator with the Cook County Circuit Court, an arbitrator, and I've been on the county board for the last 5 years. I have this budget for the state's attorney's office memorized and all the other budget matters that pertain to the county government, which we're going to balance without any tax increases, I want to let you know today. Isn't that right, Commissioner? That's right. So thank you very much. I look forward to a vigorous campaign, and we are going to have some fun. Thank you, Frank.
Commissioner, why don't you stay up here? And all the other commissioners can stay up here. We're going to take some photos to release to the various newspapers in this community. And then if everybody can come up here, and then the questions will be addressed to everybody. Everybody will be given a chance to answer. I guess they're going to stand here. They have a throne. Whoever the winner is gets the throne. And I want to say that I know almost all these lawyers and elected officials, and they're all very excellent candidates. Whoever wins, they will make an excellent choice for Cook County State's attorney.
It's not just to put the people within the criminal system and have their life getting wasted. I know there are many programs. Whereas the judge who left earlier, he shed the light in terms of you get elected, you will have a very important role to play. When you will be asking the judges to either prescribe a punishment or time, or maybe then you will have some other choices too in terms of showing some compassion, not only for the victim also, but also for the offenders. If you see historically, people from the minority, the population within the criminal justice system is increasing day in and day out, especially between the youth, between the age of 24, 18 and 35. What you will do in terms of, as you strive to establish the justice, but at the same time to show the compassion that we do rehabilitate the offenders and value the life. And I, with that note, I will also thank and I recognize the contribution of our former governor who had commuted those people who were in the jail and they were on the death row, and for the same the reason that one life is too much to be
wasted. Well, the state's attorney established or defines the just in the Justice Department, and that's a very, very powerful office. Any individual who has that kind of authority. My background is one of balance. I grew up in public housing, in public schools, in the city. I worked as a prosecutor. I worked as a criminal defense attorney. And so I can see both sides of an issue. And yes, there is room for prosecution, for retribution, if you want to call it that, and for rehabilitation and restorative programs as well. And I do favor that because I appreciate the importance of that. Well over half the cases in our criminal justice system are drug-related cases. We have a drug law war that's a failed policy. The only thing we succeeded in doing is making felons of African-American males over one-third or one-half in some cities across the nation. We must end this trend. So yes, I can have compassion because that's my upbringing, it's part of who I am. I don't have to be taught that or influenced to do or be compassionate because that is my background. That's who I am, and I pledge to do that as the next day's attorney.
We need to be smarter on crime. There are a lot of people talking about being tougher just for the sake of being tough, but one of the things that can be done, it should be done, and needs to be done in this office is to have policies and procedures in place so that the same justice you get in Markham is the same justice you get in Rolling Meadows, which is the same justice you get in Bridgeview, and the same justice you get at 26 in California. Currently, there are not a playbook for each individual. Assistant State's Attorney does things a little bit differently depending on where they are particularly situated. And so we're going to stop that. There are things that should not be prosecuted the way that they have in a view of being able to be fair to litigants. The instance that Judge Grimer talked about is a prime example of overreaching and overcharging kids who made a mistake and a high school type of prank. The same type of thing has existed, and I've represented a kid who was charged with a felony of a misdemeanor for pulling a fire alarm. And so those are some of the things that really need to be looked at. We will look at those things and not give people felonies for the sake of felonies, but make sure that the crime and the punishment fits the crime. Thank you.
I think the key is balance. That word came up in the question. Balance is the key because that's what we need to do. You know, we have a saying in our office, and that means to do the right thing. Well, doing the right thing isn't necessarily always going to trial and convicting someone. We have diversion programs. We have drug school is something that we take great pride in, and it's a program we'd love to expand. And it's a program we always seem to be fighting to get more money for. But we've had great success with that particular program, and we'd like to continue it. We'd like to expand it. There are also the rep court. There's one in Maywood, there's one in 26th Street. Great success with that too, with people who have previous convictions for drug offenses get another chance to keep themselves out of jail with an intensive 18-month probation period. And again, that is something that we would all benefit from if we were able to expand those programs. The whole concept of balance and restorative justice at the juvenile level is something that has enabled us to reduce the number of cases from 22,000 to 8,000. If we can get to those kids at that age and keep them away from 26th in California, then we have succeeded. So those are the types of programs that I think are important for this office, and I think balance is the key, and again, I think that's something that I would offer you as the next state's attorney.
I think you started juvenile justice. One of the things that has to happen, I think, is expand the jurisdiction in the juvenile courts by a year. There are too many people who are getting that first felony conviction between their 17th and their 18th birthday. I think the second thing is that we have to make sure that all of the good programs that we have are available in all of the courts and throughout the county so that everybody has an opportunity to the same diversion-type programs that exist. Third, we need to be reviewing these cases more to find patterns of where there are police work that is shoddy, but consistently shoddy, and consistently seems to target one particular group or another. I think if we do those things, we can improve the quality of justice in this county. The other thing is, we have to keep working and training assistant state's attorneys to understand what it means to be the protector of the Constitution, to be the person who is there standing between injustice and justice, to make sure that their responsibility is not overwhelmed sometimes by the workload, and that each day when they see a problem, they will get assistance from supervisors and others in the office to make sure justice is being done.
Thank you, Larry. I stated this before, but I think it's important to state it again. The state's attorney's office, as some would like to have it here, but the state's attorney's office is not a social service agency. The state's attorney's office has the responsibility to enforce the law. The state's attorney's office has a responsibility to be the advisor to the constitutionally elected officers, the president of the county board, also has a responsibility to enforce the election law abuses, open meeting acts abuses, Freedom of Information Act abuses, and other school board matter abuses, all kinds of local government abuses that go on in Cook County. The chief judge has the responsibility to create programs and administer programs that will try to rehabilitate and provide through the judicial system supervision, probation, or rehabilitation. And true, we do need to have diversion at a much, much greater scale. But most importantly, we need to have reforms brought into the Chicago Police Department so that Chicago police officers don't have a quota to fill, where they have to arrest so many people per day, clog up the courts, cases are dismissed, stricken with leave. All they're doing is just creating busy work and filling up the system with people who are self-abusers. And the concept of station intervention, where at the police station the officers should be given certain discretion to issue a warning, a citation, or to administer some other kind of counseling or intervention, or even refer into a treatment program without going into the court with these self-abusers, is something that we need to do to take out these 110,000 or so people that come through the criminal justice system every year. Thank you.